The conference. Anybody who's done conferences knows it's a lot of work and attention to detail. And I'm sure I speak for everyone when I express appreciation. I first met Esa. Everything to me goes back to Hegel and Kierkegaard. And I'll talk about that a little. But when I first met Esa, it was in the late 90s at a Hegel conference. And he at that time, I think, was the youngest or nearly youngest tenured professor in philosophy at the University of Helsinki, and the lead member in the rock band that had the number one hit at that time. And that's always been sort of emblematic of Esa for me. The conference today, it's been strange series of reflections, almost as if it were planned logically. We began with ornament and its erasure, quasi-erasure, or not quite iconoclasm, but the issue of image and its absence. And I just had an extraordinarily moving talk on Temple of Non-Being, about which I had not known, but very, very interesting. I'm going to begin by talking about nothing. I regularly teach a seminar entitled Nothing, and indeed many of my colleagues think I'm teaching nothing even when I think I'm not. I live in the United States, in the city and the country, and I'm going to begin this afternoon with the city and end with the mountains in the country. Every day when I walk to my office in New York City, I go up Broadway to 120th, and on the corner of Broadway and 112th, I pass Tom's Restaurant. Now, I'm told you all here know Seinfeld, and that's where the show Seinfeld was filmed. So I want to begin with a video from Seinfeld.
Let's have the TV show. Come up with anything?
No, nothing.
Why don't they have salsa up there?
What do you need salsa for?
Salsa is now the number one condiment in America.
Do you know why? Because people like to say salsa. Excuse me, do you have any salsa? We need more salsa. Where is the salsa? No salsa.
You know, it must be impossible for a Spanish person to order salsa and not get salsa.
I wanted salsa, not salsa. Don't you know the difference between salsa and salsa? You have the salsa after the salsa.
Maybe you should finish up.
What?
Yes. Just talk.
Yeah.
No, I'm really serious. I think that's a good idea.
Just talking? Well, what's the show about?
It's about nothing.
No story?
No, forget the story.
You gotta have a story.
Who says you gotta have a story? Remember when we were waiting for that table in that Chinese restaurant that time? That could be a TV show.
And who's on the show? Who are the characters?
I could be a character.
You?
Yeah, you base a character on me.
So on the show, there's a character named George Costanza?
Yeah. What, there's something wrong with that? I'm a character. People are always saying to me, you know, you're quite a character.
And who else is on the show?
Elaine could be a character. Kramer.
Now he's a character. So everybody I know is a character on the show.
Right.
And it's about nothing.
Absolutely nothing.
So you're saying I go into NBC and tell them I got this idea for a show about nothing.
We ain't going to NBC.
We? Since when are you a writer?
A writer? We're talking about a sitcom.
You want to go with me to NBC?
Yeah, I think we really got something here.
What do we got?
An idea.
What idea?
An idea for the show.
I still don't know what the idea is.
It's about nothing.
Right.
Everybody's doing something. We'll do nothing.
So we go into NBC, we tell them we got an idea for a show about nothing.
Exactly.
They say, what's your show about? I say nothing.
There you go.
I think you may have something here.
Quintessential postmodern moment. Now I want to go from the ridiculous to what some would call the sublime. I'll do a little bit of heavy duty philosophy and then we'll get into images. Man, one being above others, pursues science. In this pursuit, nothing less transpires than the eruption by one being called man into the whole of beings. Indeed, in such a way that through this eruption, beings break open and show what they are and how they are. The eruption that breaks open in this way helps being above all to themselves. But what is remarkable is that precisely in the way that scientific man secures to himself what is most properly his, he speaks of something different. What should be examined are beings only, and besides that, nothing. Beings alone, and further, nothing. Solely beings, and beyond that, nothing. What about this nothing? Das Nichts. Against it, science must somehow reassert its seriousness and soberness of mind, insisting that it is not concerned solely with being, but nothing. What else can it be for science but an outrage and a phantasm? If science is right, then only one thing is sure. Science wishes to know nothing of the nothing. Ultimately, this is the scientifically rigorous conception of nothing. We wish to know nothing about it. Science wants to know nothing of the nothing. How is it with the nothing? I think a lot of what is most interesting in philosophy and theology to me is nothing. Certain understanding of nothing, which is not simply the absence of being, but something in between being and what we call non-being. For Heidegger, the scientific worldview focuses on discrete entities and analyzes them through methods of calculation based upon instrumental reason. And Heidegger sees that if modern science and technology, calculative reason and instrumental reason, is a culmination of a long philosophical tradition that begins with Descartes. And he sees in Descartes the crucial move, cogito ergo sum, of reducing what he says is truth to certainty, which is self-certainty. He thinks that move of reducing truth to certainty ends finally with Nietzsche's will of power, which is the will of mastery, which seeks to control, dominate, and master all of creation, such that the whole world becomes, for Heidegger, from that point of view, a standing reserve for human being. And in that, forgets what he calls nothing, which becomes very close to being. In his whole effort, he says, the task of thinking at the end of philosophy is to think what philosophy has left unthought. What philosophy has left unthought is precisely this weird nothing. Now, science is part of the title of the seminar, and Heidegger invokes it in the sense that I've just indicated. But if we look historically, that is, if we go back to the beginning of modernity, we should look back a little bit farther than Descartes, science and theology were more closely related, right? I think there are basically two types of theology in the West, and I think speak mostly in the West. One that gives priority to what we might call word, in the beginning is the word. One that gives priority to deed, in the beginning is the deed. The former, you can understand as paradigmatically represented in high medieval theology, the type of Thomas Aquinas, where Thomas says at one point, God's will always follows God's reason. Right? That leads to a long tradition, which eventually, some of the theory that I will talk about as logocentrism, that privileges language structure and informal structure. The other pole is traced back to William of Ockham, which is a model, who was one of the primary influences behind Luther, where he gives priority to divine will. If God is above all omnipotent will. Right? If God is above all omnipotent will, you cannot have deductive modes of reasoning, you must have inductive modes of reasoning. Because God's will is bound by nothing other than God's will. So whatever God does, You have to know what God does. You have to look at what has occurred. That tradition led not only to various forms of nominalist theology, called nominalism, formerly called realism, right? But that form of thinking, right, led to British empiricism. So the British empirical tradition, because Occam worked at Oxford. I always say Occam, I think, is the last original thinker Oxford ever had. But that tradition of language analysis comes out of that voluntaristic theological position. Newton and Newtonian physics came out of that voluntarist tradition. Right? So that Newton actually wrote more theological treatises than he did treatises on physics, and spent most of his career as the head of the Mint in England. So you have empiricism coming out of that tradition. Throughout the 18th century, the primary way in which God was invented was through this empirical tradition. There are three classical arguments for the existence of God: the cosmological, the teleological, and the ontological. The cosmological and the teleological were the main arguments for the existence of God during that period. God, they are from effect to cause, from the existence of the world to God as cause, or from the design of the world to God as cause. Kant comes along and Hume renders that line of analysis unsustainable. Kant comes along and tries to shift from depending in terms of cognition to depending in terms of volition, moral law, and the like. That runs shipwreck for various reasons, and in Kant's third critique, so Kant had three critiques, and for Kant, the critique is, it's not criticism, it's reflection on the conditions of the possibility of knowledge, the true, morality, the good, and aesthetics, the beautiful. The third critique marks a significant transition that leads to a reinterpretation of art. And at the end of the 18th century, the beginning of the 19th century, Schleiermacher is a central figure here, you have the shift from interpreting religion in terms of either knowledge or will to interpret it in terms of art and aesthetics. And art begins to displace religion as a form of spiritual expression. The central concept for Kant, and I don't have time to go into the detail here, is what he calls this notion of inner teleology. The central idea in Kant is autonomy, self-determination. Right? That self-determination can take place theoretically, can take place practically, or aesthetically. And this notion of purposiveness without purpose, that is to say, an intrinsic purpose. Purpose is not something done instrumentally for something to get you to somewhere else, but it's its own purpose. That becomes the normative position for what becomes the definition of art for modernity. All the way down, and Kent mentioned this morning, to Clement Greenberg, whose definition of art is explicitly lifted from Kant, right? So critical art is art that's about art. It's self-reflexive, it's non-referential. It doesn't point to anything beyond itself. The problem at that point comes from representation, right? Because what critical philosophy is, it's self-representation. Self represents itself to itself. There's nothing outside that self-reflexive circuit of exchange. So if you think about this in semiotic terms, right, if you think about it theologically, that's semiotically. The question becomes one of representation. What's the relationship in a sign? You have a signifier and you have a signifier. The question is, what's the relationship between those two? And in all these arguments, there's an effort to try to overcome the bifurcation, the split between the signifier and the signifier. Right? Two ways to do it. The one end, you erase the signifier to get to the pure signified. That can take the form of immediacy, as it does on the Schleiermacher. We're going to take the form of abstraction and formalism. The other alternative is to get rid of the signified and collapse everything into the signifier. At that point, you end up with a play of signs. The former leads to modernism, the latter to postmodernism. So, Ken made an argument for ornament this morning. This is Adolf Loos, whose famous book is entitled Ornament as Crime. severe critique of ornamentation in an effort to strip away ornament and get the pure structure. There's a politics in that, there's a psychology in that, there's a theology in that. But what we associate with high modern architecture today comes out of this kind of tradition, Corbusier. Get rid of all the crooked lanes and have streets, the radiant city, straight line, right angles. The context in which modern architecture emerged in Europe and in the United States is very different. In Europe, as you all know, emerges intimately tied to the rebuilding of Europe after the wars. It's introduced in the United States in 1932 at an exhibition at MoMA, curated by Philip Johnson, called International Style and Architecture. Important title, because it inserted the word style. Right? And I want to talk about style as a way, because I'll look for those who argue for ornament, getting rid of ornament and having pure structure, is a critique of style. Right? But the purism of that architecture, of that art, is every bit as much style as anything else. The style of non-style is the most stylish of all. Right? Whether it's in fashion, whether it's in minimalism, whether it's in conceptualism. Right? No escaping style. Johnson was, this is the Seagram's building on Park Avenue in New York City. And Johnson was this Mies van der Rohe's first building in New York. And Philip Johnson was his assistant on that. This sort of becomes quintessential modernist architecture. Then along came the 1960s, and social and cultural revolutions of all sorts in the United States. In 1968, three architects, Robert Venturi, Denise Scott Brown, and Stephen Eisenhower, did a studio at Yale University on Las Vegas. And in 1971 or 72, that book was published as Learning from Las Vegas. This is where postmodernism in the United States begins. It begins in architecture and eventually spreads into other areas. Right? And Venturi wrote a book in 1966 called Complexity and Contradiction in Architecture. To me, says less is more. Venturi says less is a bore. And what he tries to do is to develop vernacular architecture that draws on what is now emerging consumer and culture in this. And he took, what he did was he said that, like, you want to understand America, you've got to look at Las Vegas, see the strip as sort of a place for automobiles, where the buildings and the strip were all simply squares and all. They were the pretext for the sign. Because in front of the casinos and the hotels were vast parking lots of people, to get people into the casinos, you had to have the sign. So this image here, he takes from the sign for the Monticello Hotel in Las Vegas. Johnson develops his version, postmodern version of what had been Mises, Seagram's building. Now the same kind of structure. Look at the top, no longer flat, sorry, covered with decoration of a certain sort with granite. That's the sign, literally, taken from the Monticello Hotel. After this book came out, there was a plethora, an outbursting of architecture as opposite from high modernism as you can imagine. This is Michael Graves from Disney World. Michael Graves, Charles Moore, Stanley Tigerman, there were a lot of them at this time. What Venturi saw was that in the 60s and all, there was a new communications technology emerging, new media were emerging. And he saw this as having broad cultural implications. And that was going to involve a different understanding of communication through images. I think one of the problems with philosophy, is its overemphasis on the conceptual and the cognitive, and its underemphasis on the affective. And I think that a lot of that in philosophy is a result of the preoccupation with language in all its multiple forms. The whole in philosophy was talked about as a linguistic term. I think what we need is an aesthetic term that begins to look at various, cultivating different styles of writing and of communicating philosophically, right? And so part of what I've been doing over the past, I don't know how many years, and I want to share that with you, is trying to extend the bounds of philosophical writing in certain ways. I believe that we can apprehend things that we cannot comprehend. And in English, I don't know if it works in Finnish and Swedish, apprehension is a nice word. It means to cognize, but it's also the kind of nervousness within all of that. And I think part of that is, will involve, and I'll try to show how this works out, a return or recovery of various aspects of bodily materiality and the like. So conscious and self-consciousness obviously are all interrelated, and this is only simplified. I think it's a two-way street. But I think, obviously, thinking and acting are influenced by sensibility, intuition, perception, which shape consciousness, and vice versa, comes right down this way. So imaging, we see this today with the way in which the electronic media changed literally the way our brains work, and certainly the way our children's brains work physiologically and neurologically as well as cognitively. In the early 90s, I began trying to figure out new ways of communicating this stuff. As I say, everything I've done has sort of been trying to figure out some middle position between Hegel's both and Kierkegaard's either or. And I started reading Deconstruction and Derrida, whose ideas have deeply influenced me. I found what seemed to me to be neither both and nor either or. Neither or, somewhere in between. And my first effort to work those ideas out was Erie. If I were doing this today, this is a labyrinth by Robert Morris. If I were doing it today, I wouldn't have that image on the book. Cover the book. Because labyrinth has a center. He has a new labyrinth in Kansas City that does not have that center. But I didn't use any images in, but some drawings but no real images in the book. I tried to use stylistic gestures in the writing that were different but not visual yet. I then did a book that you referred to this morning, Disfiguring, in which I tried to look at interrelation between religion, art, and architecture. When I look at religion, I don't look at explicitly religious architecture, I look at or art. I find religion most interesting, or at least obvious. I think there's a religious dimension to all culture, right? So I wasn't looking at religious paintings and churches and cathedrals and mosques, but this is Anselm Kiefer's Zitzum, which is drawn from Kabbalah, obviously, and also has a lot to do with nothing. And some of the images from the Temple of Non-Being are reminiscent of what Kiefer tries to do. One of the chapters in that book was on post-abstract expressionist art. And I was working on that chapter, and I called it currency. I was trying to think through three notions of currency. One, up-to-dateness, this is modern, postmodern, right? Two, money, and three, electricity, current. And part of what I was beginning to see was going on at that time was a new financial system that was emerging, where currency, money was currency, electricity. But I was working on a chapter about that had a long section on Andy Warhol, and he was a very, very interesting figure. Business art is the step that comes after art. I started as a commercial artist, started painting signs like the first exhibition of Warhol's work in the United States was in Bamba Tower window. Indeed, modern art was introduced in America in department stores. Primarily John Wanamaker first, they actually had all the early modern masses. That's where they were shown first. And I want to finish, I started as a commercial artist, I want to finish as a business artist. After I did the thing called art or whatever it's called, I went into business art. I wanted to be an art businessman or business artist. Being good in business is the most fascinating kind of art. As I'm working on this chapter, I had an idea that to this day, I don't know where it came from, to do a course using teleconferencing that Bent refers to. So I called Esa. And of course, I said, dynamite, let's do it, right? This is 1990. So we began developing it. Actually, one time, met in the Copenhagen Airport to draw up the syllabus for that course. And we eventually pulled it off. It wasn't easy. They used the finished telecommunications studio. We and William Sound had to figure out how to do it ourselves. Imageology is the word we thought we made up, but I later discovered Bandera uses it at one point. I was thinking, you know, sort of mythology only images, trying to think through how images function for us today, like myths have functioned in other times. This is a photograph of our classroom in Williamstown. We had, a dozen students, 10, 12 students in Williamstown, 10, 12 students in Helsinki, and we met each week for an entire semester for 2 hours to discuss, you know, Heidegger, Baudrillard, the board. We didn't, no student, nor had SNI, had used email at that time. And so we knew we were doing something new. So S and I communicated back and forth in the course of that semester. And at the end of the semester, we compiled what we had done and developed it into a text, a book, what became this book. We wanted to try to bring together form and content, if you will. So we didn't want to do it. If you think about it, your standard academic monograph, you know, it looks like a beast standard or building. Straight lines, right angles, black and white. We did this black and white, but we didn't want straight angles and straight lines and right angles. So we found a woman, I forget her name.
Maria.
Yeah, her.
Oh, you mean Kirsi?
No, not Kirsi.
The designer is woman. Mariana Birsa.
Yeah. Esa knew her, and we met with her, explained to her what we wanted, and she did a spectacular job and has gone on to a very distinguished career here. One of Esa's many friends was the woman, Kirsi, who was the head, who at that time was the head of Mary Metco. She became intrigued by all of this, and Mary Metco had produced a whole product line in the pages of the book. I'll come back to that. They made what they called V-shirts out of this, black on white, white on black, any other kinds of things. Understanding has become impossible because nothing stands under. I can't read the rest of it. Understanding becomes unavoidable because everything stands between. Right. So, you know, it's McLuhan-esque in certain ways. And that was part of what was in our mind. The product line that she called Media Text. And they had shirts, backpacks, bed sheets, umbrellas, denim jackets. But it became a very, very interesting extension of some of the issues that we were dealing with in that course in terms of the ways in which design, in a broad sense of that term, impacts our lives. They're the V-shirts that Mary Metco did. We've written this book and had the text at the time we talked around. So then I wanted to do something that in which I work with designers from the beginning. Not do the text first, but explain to them, you know, what it was. And I had, over the course of the years, I've become involved in discussions in architecture. And through Red Pool House, I've gotten to know, I found some designers in New York, 2x4 design, who were really, really good, theoretically, and who really understood it. And we worked together from the beginning of what became Heidi. Most of my books, the titles have multiple meanings. This is a book about surfaces and superficiality. One of the texts in, that I had up here just a minute ago had superficiality. In English, hide is spelled to conceal, right? But it's also skin. And this, the actual cover of this book is hot pink, right? This is a yellow wrap that turns it orange, and the wrap feels like dead skin. The design of the book is layered, laid out multiply. The first chapter is on phrenology, skin disease, detective fiction, Paul Auster's detective fiction, and Nancy Burson's photography. It all has to do with the interplay of surfaces and of layering and the like. The underimage here is of ceramic skin, because the detective fiction, I don't know if you know the singing detective. It's a story about a detective fiction writer who's in the hospital with psoriasis, writing a book about a story with detective fiction. But psoriatic skin reproduces every 7 days rather than 28 days, so there's a constant kind of layering and peeling of the skin. Those other images are images of patients with psoriatic skin. Again, we're trying to enact, I don't want you to represent, I want you to enact the argument in the design of the book. Right? And so we had all kinds of strategies. So the first chapter, as I said, the second chapter was on tattooing, body art, and piercing. The third chapter was on fashion. Fourth chapter was on postmodern architecture in Las Vegas. And the fifth chapter is the genealogy of virtual technologies. This pushed the book as far in the direction of multimedia hypertext as I could do it. And then I want to take it into electronic space. So I said, Venturi interpreted Las Vegas as emblematic of 20th century automobile culture. I saw the difference between the strip in the 70s, 60s and 70s, and the strip of the 80s and 90s, and the difference between automobile culture and virtual culture. So we created this is the end of a very, to err amidst shifty interfaces that know no end is to live an irreducible enigma. Nothing is hiding. And you read that nothing is hiding in two ways. Right. Nothing is always hiding, and there's nothing hiding. So a student of mine and I created a video game. And the video game is not of the book, but rather it engages all the themes in the book. We call it Hotel Real, Las Vegas, Nevada. Real is a reference to Dr. Khan, right? The interface is clunky. I mean, we just did it with, we didn't have any money to do it, but the interface is a slot machine. The Motel Real has 52 rooms, weeks of the year, decks of the card, and each room has a little narrative associated with it that deals with the theme of the book, right? And you navigate through by playing the slot machine. We even made a bumper sticker for the virtual motel. But the hiding and real were, for me, two parts of the same work. Of course, nobody really got that, but it's not new. I then began to have some reservation, because I'd done a lot with this virtual culture. I'd started a company providing online education every day, and some of the things began to turn out in ways I hadn't expected. This process of dematerialization, this process of virtualization, this process of the denial and repression of the body in certain ways. So I began trying to think about the implications of that. You know, I said I started my career with Kirkor, as you probably know. In Danish, Kirkor means cemetery. I had always done grave rubbings of what I call my ghosts. And I'd imagined for a long time doing a book photographs of the graves of the modern greats, artists, writers, philosophers. So I identified 150, which is an interesting name. No politicians, these are the people I thought would shape modern culture. Grave matters, you can read in three ways. Right? Graves matter, serious matters, right? And grave is the materiality of all this. I didn't take these photographs. I couldn't spend, but a former student of mine who was a professional photographer spent 6 months, 1 year in Europe and Russia, and 6 months the next year in the United States taking these photographs. This is Hegel's grave. Hegel's buried right next to Fichte in Berlin. This is Kierkegaard's grave. These are my ghosts in Copenhagen. And this is Nietzsche's grave. At each grave, we shot that with film, not digitally. And at each grave site, we collected some dirt, matter. Right. And we smuggled the dirt back into the States, where it's illegal to bring dirt back. And eventually, this book turned into a big exhibition at Massachusetts Museum of Contemporary Art. And from the dirt pan, this is sort of a Donjon light box illuminated from below, and all the dirt canisters are here. We suspended it. And look at the shape. Is that shape will return. In the early 1990s, I became involved with the work of one of America's most important earthworks artists. In the 1960s, when the gallery system was going crazy, there were critics about the commodification of works of art, and there were different artists tried to develop ways to create non-commodifiable art. That's where performance came from, some of video came from, and that's where tattooing came from, serious tattoo renaissance. And for some of these guys, and they were guys, they went out in the West, Robert Smithson, James Sorrell, and Michael Heiser. I spent time out in Nevada with Heiser, who was 135 miles north of Vegas, 35 miles back up their road, farther from civilization I've ever been, where he does his work. Desert's covered with bones. And I picked up some bones, they sat around my study for some years, and I started photographing. And by this time, I learned digital, so I did this book, and the photos, so we go from graves to bones, and we get the direction. And these are some of the photographs. I did 40 photographs, desert, 40 days, 40 nights, all that. These are vertebrae in the mountains. I then began to become interested in taking philosophy off the page. Scholars sit at desks and look out windows. They write books while sitting at desks. That's it. But if I was right that there are things that we apprehend that we can't comprehend, and this is what ritual is about in religion, there's certain activities, right, that lead to certain kinds of knowledge. So I started what has become an extensive project. This is a book that includes my photographs and writing about what I've been trying to do. It's an ongoing project. I've designed this to be seen on different angles of the ground and from the air. This is, it's developed quite a bit since this. This is our home. That's the barn where I have a study. These are some metal sculptures that I'll show you. This, we look due west. So what I did was I calculated the solstice axes. And this is the summer solstice, and this is the winter solstice. Incomplete figure eights, infinity, Mobius strip. In the center, the empty center. And there's a center within the center. There's a 5 meter. This is 100 feet, so what's that, 34 meters. This is 5 meter in diameter, dry stone constructed fire pit, where we actually have fires. About 6-7 years ago, this was all woods, and I cleared it. We put in pond streams, Zen rock garden here. This is the fire pit up here. we've been there 20 years, and in these fields, there were rock outcroppings that I never knew were there. That we saw in the gallery, I say this sort of reminds me. This is granite. That's 2.5 tons. So with these blocks, we cut off the bottom and figured out ways to mount those. The smaller ones in the back are 0.5 ton each. I mentioned Heiser a few minutes ago. I wanted to use this image on one of my books, but I couldn't get to him to get permission. And Peter Eisman said one day he's working on a project he would get to him. So I used it on this book. In English, you can read that as tears for tears. Heidegger's notion of the clearing in the opening talks about it as the wrist, the design, which is wrist as a tear or an opening in all this. When I couldn't get Heiser's permission for that, I used this image, which is by a painting by Mark Tansey, who's interesting to me because Tansey has gone through in his development all the stages I've gone through, my sort of modernism, or critique of modernism, did deconstruction of it. He actually did paintings using underlayered texts from Derrida and De Man and Baudrillard and Foucault, and then moved into complexity theory, which I've also done. And again, alternative is usually spelled with an E. I switched it to an A to repeat Derrida's difference and have different nuances. And this image, you recognize where that comes from? No reason you should. It's the backside of the Tower of Babel. It's a Masonic image. But again, a pyramid with its tip knocked off, and I'll come back to that. Here it is. The first metal sculpture I did was this one. And it was inspired by an essay that Derrida has. It's a critique of Hegel's semiotics and theory of the sign, called the pit and the pit and the pyramid. Plays on Poe, right? So I made a pyramid with a tip knocked off, and a steel, and then my idea was to make all the solids, but broken, right? Because what I'm trying to do here is to create an interchange between the modern, the postmodern, the abstract, the concrete, the material, the immaterial, the organic, and the machinic, right? And put them in tension with each other. I then decided, because the first thing that I wrote about for Heiser, they asked me to write an essay on one of his big works called Double Negative. I won't go into that. It's a big earthwork 80 miles north of Vegas on a slice in the mesa out there. So I made this is the precise negative image of that. Same size, done negative. So I have positive, I have negative next to those. This is Heiser's. So out in the middle of the desert, he's building, won't let anybody see it, and he won't let him photograph it, so hard to get photographed. Back 35 miles back this dirt road, it's called the city. And it is 6 kilometers long. And all below the surface of the earth. It boggles the mind. It looks like a Mayan plaza or something like that. And this is an early stage. It's called Pop Complex 1. But again, the image of the truncated pyramid. This is in Beacon, a museum in the United States. But here you see a square, circle, so on and so forth. These were in the back of my mind when I was doing that negative, positive kind of interplay with the truncated pyramids and all this. Here's one of the concentric cubes that I did. And I designed this to be seen from the air as well. Here's a broken sphere. It's only half a sphere. It has a hole in the middle. This is that sphere from the sky, where it loses its three-dimensionality and becomes its one dimension. This is another more abstract work that I've done as part of this whole process. The point is this is the fire pit from the sky as it gradually elevates. I sold him into tattooing.
That becomes
the incarnation of the image. And then here you see, this is the modernist moment. This is the postmodernist moment. Grid, straight, inside closed, immaterial, geometric form. Crooked web, outside open, material, organic matter. Improper, dirty sense, obscurity, archaic, incalculable place. Proper, clean, reason, transparent, modern, valuable space. They intersect. That's nothing. That's the hole in the middle that makes it possible to have the wheel. And then I said the great matters was sort of they're my ghosts. They're all our ghosts. They live through us and we live through them. So I decided I needed to pay homage to my ghosts, my Holy Trinity, Kierkegaard, Hegel, and Nietzsche. So Nietzsche, as you know, went mad at age 44. And the last things that he wrote, he signed Dionysus the Antichrist. This is actually at the end of the last things he wrote. I just finished a book called Last Works, and the last thing who people wrote. And I found this image of his writing with a D, and I took the D and blew it up into a 5.5-meter seal sculpture. This is one of the rocks that was completely covered with earth. I didn't know it was there. It's marble. We stripped it off and put a garden around it. This changes with different angles. You can see the shadows, how this changes. It's steel. I coat the steel with salt water to give it so that it rusts that way. I published Kierkegaard's doodles. Right? At that time, I was into Derrida, the postcard, everything. So I made a postcard out of Kierkegaard's doodles. And this is Kierkegaard's signature. So I took the K in his signature to create this sculpture, which is 5.5 meters tall and about 6 meters wide for this. But the last one I have to do, this is an aerial shot. Of it. These are negative pieces taken from the sheets of steel we use for that. And we suspended this. It was incredibly difficult to do this. And I wanted the gap to stay, because that's the empty center that makes everything else work. So technically that is very, very difficult to do, because we had to weld it while it was suspended with a front loader. My last one is Hegel, and next week when I go home, we've got to figure out how to install this. This is the H. We have it done. It's a little bit hard to see. But this is you can see the figure here from the H that we just did. That one obviously isn't outside yet. Once you get it, figure out how to place it stably, I'll float that with salt water and it'll look like the others, hopefully. So, again, it's been a question of style, trying to find different ways to express these ideas. In different media, in my own head, there are various kinds of arguments going on here. And so I'll end now with the summary of this one. I call this overall project Nexus, which, you know, interconnecting all that. Can we start?
Thank you. dear friends, that was beautiful, and this is such a great moment for me because I've known Mark. What's happening with the? I've known. I've known Mark for 25 years, and now I have about 50 minutes during which he has to listen. And what I'm going to do is that I'm going to present my philosophy about Mark. It's going to be kind of a theory. It's going to be a theory about. With the sort of Mark-like title. It's a theory about Mark, the original, which is how I first perceive Mark's work and Mark's contribution. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to point out some, from my point of view, key aspects of Mark's originality, and doing that at the same time, I hope I'm going to make a case for originality itself. So it's like marking originality through marking some aspects of Mark. Now, it's been a long day, we have foreign guests here, so I'd like to do something for 1 minute and introduce to our foreign guests a Finnish custom, which is gaining more and more ground by the day. Something called the tender and dynamic moment of meeting, with which Finns more and more like to start a lecture. But Finns don't really like to talk. So it's more like hugging, cheek kisses, give me fives, but that sort of physical stuff. So please stand up and generate tender and dynamic moment of meeting with people around you. And that's it. Beautiful, that's it. Flourishing is the title. I once asked him, Ned, what's your biggest contribution to economic theorizing? And he said, I think a lot of people would say that I've made a considerable effort to put people back to economic theorizing. Put people back. Now, an outsider to economic theorizing, I would say, might be somewhat puzzled when hearing that people have been put out from economic theorizing in the first place. I mean, each one of us, for instance, encounter economics, the phenomenon of economics, day and night. So you would expect this brilliant, powerful minds around the world in economic departments, at least it acknowledges the fact that, you know, people are related to what we are talking about. But apparently that's not the case. And this line from Professor Phelps's Nobel acceptance speech, I think highlights this rather nicely. Neoclassical growth theory in economics was conspicuous in having no people in it. Now personally, for maybe 30 years or so, I remember being kind of puzzled by the fact that when it comes to my own field, philosophy, there's tremendous emphasis on what can be known. All kinds of themes that relate to something called epistemology. And you could say, well, this is what science is about. It's about knowing. And philosophy wants to carry its part of responsibility of clarifying what such an important, noble, significant, fundamental enterprise is all about by clarifying the concept of knowing. But I remember being puzzled by the question, why is all this fuss about knowledge? Why isn't there, for instance, attention to the question of tenderness? Because tenderness is also a phenomenon of the human life. And you say, well, relatively fundamental also. If you think about the theme that Professor Bunsdorf pointed out, infant research highlights the fact that each one of us knows without any research, which is the significance of tenderness when it comes to human growth at the early ages of that growth. So to me, it was like something like the phenomenon that Professor Phelps here points out with regard to economic theorizing would take place in the context of my own field. Now, this is the context, I think, of Marx's contribution. Now, here's a couple of quotations from Marx that I think are symbolic of his effort. Art creates the opening through which the future approaches. Again, you can say, well, wouldn't it seem like the future should be something that we live with all the time? I mean, wouldn't it have to be something that we just sort of keep in mind at all times, future? So to the extent that we need something to open an opening with, you'd say, it seems like there seem major forces that perhaps close to something that, according to Marx, art seeks to open. But similarly, what if philosophy were to become more artful and art more philosophical? You'd say, wasn't the idea originally of philosophy to contribute to the cause of the good life? Well, whatever the good life might be about, you could say, certainly involves the future, certainly involves opening up kind of thing. So who would come up with the idea of cutting off art from philosophy? I mean, why to do that kind of either-or sort of selection in the first place? And it's in this context, I believe, where Marx's contribution stands. As from my point of view, one of the few truly Socratic philosophers of our time, this is from my point of view, who is after the cause of the better life. So it's not just that Marx would be interested in describing something, but Marx is after an effect, and there is the future aspect to it. So he wants to open up the future for something better as compared to what we now have. He doesn't offer, as it were, philosophy of better life, because it's the Socratic effort where you don't really teach the something. It's more whatever you do serves the purpose with regard to the other person. So it's better life through better thinking. So it's thinking as the realm with which we operate, that Mark, I believe, operates with. But it's this kind of Socratic idea in mind of better life resulting from that. Unlike Socrates himself, Mark loves writing. He loves to write, and he loves what other people have written. I'm 62 years of age, and I've had the honor of coming to know really remarkable people. I don't know anybody who reads as much as Mark does. And it's also what you would call serious reading. So he loves writing. Now, you could sense that in his presentation just now. You could sense that, you know, for somebody to go with that kind of intensity to some particular paragraph in Heidegger, you know, the person has read so much of Heidegger. He loves writing, but even more than writing, or even more than any other forms of representing the reality or life itself, whatever you call it, he loves the magic of life itself, I think. Now, I put the words "the magic of" here to parenthesis, because I recognize we are sort of a scholarly context and so forth. So you know, science mentioned the title. One recognizes the fact that we are here approaching the theme of nothing. And that is that area where your words somehow don't capture what you try to capture them with. This is the theme of apprehension, as Mark put it, as opposed to comprehension. Let me say it this way. Over the years, I've come to know so many brilliant people, and it's great to be in the presence of somebody who is tremendously brilliant. Not only in terms of you learning so much, but also in terms of just sort of feeling, you know, with admiration, the fact that somebody's brains are really tuned to something big. But it's only some of those brilliant minds that maintain excitement in life itself, as opposed to some particular representations of life. And this is not any criticism, it's just, I believe, acknowledging the fact. I mean, you go to most departments of economics in the world and you find instances of this phenomenon. And to repeat, this is not criticism, it's just describing the fact. But it's that kind of lifestyle, I believe, that Marx wants to move towards the future that would be better. He does this by cherishing phenomena that have some kind of claim for the nothing, where the nothing has, as it were, prima facie more room to breathe than in some other contexts, such as religion. I mean, you can say, well, what's religion? Well, it's not one of things, but they, you know, maybe it relates to, let's say, phenomena like sacredness. You know, people feeling awe. You know, it's difficult to say what the phenomenon is, but at least there is some room to breathe for, you know, that kind of admiration for life's miracle in the context of religion, something to argue. And similarly for art, And even more controversially, I would say, for philosophy itself, Marx's own field and my own field, but we know that philosophy as a profession in the academic context has become even more than economics, I would say, alienated from people. So it's in this context where Marx's characteristic intensity, we sense it today. I mean, you pick up any of Marx's 30 books, and you open any of those books anywhere, and irrespective of how much you can immediately understand what's written, you sense the intensity. And as you read more deeply into, let's say, a couple of pages, what you see is, what you did see now also, what you see is this rare combination of respect for the detail, connected with the respect for the bigger picture. And all this in the context of the something that we experienced towards the very end with Marx's Nexus video, which is the phenomenon I would here call elevation, some kind of uplift, the fact that people have abilities to reach out towards what's sometimes called transcendent hope. And it's that phenomenon that I'd like to illustrate with my little video. This is going to be 2.5 minutes, and it's going to be a music performance, one that I like very much. It's one that sort of to me brings out, illustrates, sort of points towards some of the sort of Marx kind of originalities. As it starts, you can sense that the singer, the great Spanish tenor Plácido Domingo, is tremendously intense. So intensity to the present moment is theme number one. This is the sort of Marx kind of attitude. Then the camera angle changes, and the conductor of the orchestra, the great Indian conductor, Chubby Mehta, comes to the picture. But from his point of view, the second part in this performance is relatively easy, an orchestra of this caliber play. So he isn't doing that much in terms of conducting the actual orchestra. He's allowing himself to enjoy the beauty of the moment. He's there with his eyes half closed, which of course conductors seldom do, because they do so much of their leading with their eyes. But he's allowing himself to do that because the orchestra knows what it's doing. But then he does something which I think is particularly significant from our tentative theory of Marx point of view, which is this sort of extending the words. It's just sort of a glance with which the conductor looks at his singer with respect and with sort of generous appreciation of what's to come. You know, there's something beautiful about to happen. So please pay attention to those 4.5 seconds that the conductor looks at his singer. And what this prepares for is the sort of moment that I believe Marx's concluding video demonstrated, the sort of nexus moment, this is the moment of elevation, which you can never really guarantee, which means that to the extent that you want to operate with conceptual systems or representation systems that can command something beforehand, you won't get it, but it's still possible for humans to reach out to something higher, which is what we'll see in this performance as it comes towards its end. You see this part of, say, magical uplift or moment of elevation to come. As the camera angle changes yet one more time, the conductor is now very demanding to the orchestra. The singer is there, quiet, with his hands in front of his face as he is focusing, knowing the demands of the concluding part. That's when the last part of elevation starts. So with these three aspects in mind, seriousness to the present moment, this kind of intensity of focus, connectedness, reaching out to the other, and then elevation in mind, let's take a look.
I want
painting or a building or a book. I want it to take me elsewhere. I want it to take me somewhere I haven't been. And not allow me to come back to where I thought I was. You know, in some ways, I mean, the dialogue that Tess and I have had over the many years, he's done that with my work because he sees things that I didn't see and teases those out in ways that are productive to me to keep sort of thinking. Because whatever that nothing that something is, it's what keeps things open and what's life and death are not simply opposites. There's a living death. And I mean, it seems to me that that's what art, that's what thinking ought to do, and that, you know, what is it that keeps it open? You can't quite say, because you could say it would be closed, right? And it's that elusiveness. And that's when Esa talks about philosophy more about it. It's true. I mean, who the heck cares about the kind of inner arguments that so often are had that have nothing to do with life and death. You know, at the end of the day, I mean, that's what it's sort of about. It's how one keeps alive and doesn't end up living a living death.
So, this is becoming a rather this is becoming a rather personal thing, but we will open the floor for some questions.
Ken? Thank you. Mark, your trajectory that you started with in your lecture, starting from, you know, Kant, and then going to jumping to Mies, of course, and the early architecture in the United States, going into the international style, and then you moved on to learning from Las Vegas, the work of Charles Moore, and so on, and Disney. And then after that, I'd just like to stop there for a moment and point and sort of recant the fact that both Venturi and Moore were very concerned with the vernacular, with the basic realities of how America was put together at that time. You know, they went out into the small towns and so on, not just Las Vegas, but the towns in Texas, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
So then you went on, then you seek to move away from that investigation that began with postmodernism, away from what they thought was the abstraction of modernism as it turned into style and so on. From there on, you went towards surfaces, media, and then finally electronic space, and then finally the virtual motel. Now, it seems to me, and then you talked about the recovering place. Now, place was a big word, especially from Moore, as well as Brinkerhoff Jackson and others at that time. But when you recovered place, what did you do? You moved to the countryside.
I lived there.
You know, of course, we all have our country places, if we're lucky enough, in New England and New York. However, what I'd like to ask you is that, if I can phrase it correctly, it seems to me that when you moved to the countryside, there were two things going on. One was your, in a sense, abandoning architecture, and moving into what we call the art world and the virtual side of the art world. And also by moving out of the city into the utopia of the northeastern countryside, you were also moving from the city, from the the kind of vernacular directness and actuality that I think postmodernism was trying to get its hands on in the beginning. So haven't you, to some extent, I don't know how to put it because I do admire your work and your thinking, but I see somewhat an escape on your part and a kind of a transcendental thing of moving into this utopian world, putting your work in your backyard. Do you agree that there is something to that trajectory that I'm trying to describe?
No.
No. I think you would have told me that. Let me ask you a question.
One more question.
How would you revisit the ordinary? How would you revisit the actuality of structure? For example, of let's say the troubled American towns and villages. How do you bring your work back into the ordinariness of our landscape that was the beginning of this movement away from high modernism?
So, I think we're mutual here because I think your emphasis on ornament is highly misguided. And one thing that is completely missing from your presentation this morning, which really represented, as I understood it, a certain kind of critique of high modernist abstraction and its dismissal of ornament, was that he mentioned postmodernism and the role of image and decoration and ornament that took place during that whole period. I didn't move to the country. I lived in the country my whole life. I moved to the city. Can you answer the question? I do think that what you think is a function of where you think. I tried to explain the work, the kinds of work that I was doing this as part of an effort to rethink the states of virtualization and globalization. Because in a virtual and globalized world, place disappears. I walk down the walking street in Stockholm, haven't been to Helsinki yet, and they're the same shops. Anyway, there's homogenization and standardization. It's an extension of what began in high modernism, but much more pervasive now. The other issue that's involved with this, and is very close to all of this, is speed and the acceleration that goes with digitization and virtualization. Whether it's high-speed financial markets, high-speed trading, high-speed communication, or what's happening with our children with attention deficit disorder and the like, there's this constant acceleration. So there are all kinds of places. Again, recovering place means at least three things. It's something that we recover because I think there are ways in which place is disappearing. I think it means to cover over again. And it's a place where you recover. It's a place that gives you an occasion to slow down and reflect. The exhibition that Ben mentioned, we called Sensing Place. And again, part of that has to do with a recovery of a certain kind of materiality, gravity, density. And part of what we'll do in that exhibition is a very careful archaeology of, we live on one end of what's called Stone Island, the other end is Sterling Francine Clark Art Institute, which is a major institution, which is where the show will be, and we're doing it about that place. So we're digging into the history going all the way back through human habitation to the geological, and then we asked 12 or 13 artists, writers who live in and around there to select one object and think about place through that specificity of that object. So it becomes a sort of laboratory for all of this. So what I intended to do with all this is a critical engagement of some of these directions that I think are unsustainable. I mean, one of the last books I did, I called Speed Limits. We reach speed limit, right? I mean, it's complicated in terms of the kinds of systems and networks that have emerged and how these complex systems, networks work. They're positive feedback systems that keep accelerating, accelerating, accelerating. And it's an effort to with Venturi, of course, I mean, I mentioned that complex and contradicts with architecture, conservative and inaccurate, what's mainstream, this, that, and the other, the different kinds of places. You want to do the kinds of thing I'm trying to do for place elsewhere. I mean, it's obvious in the design of some of this stuff that Zen gardens and the whole role that those rock, that kind of rock garden has to play, has been influential, created space for meditation and reflection and the like, because it increasingly disappears. So it's not a flight from, but it's a situating in that allows for the development of a certain kind of critical perspective on the lives we're living. I mean, that's part of what Esther was saying.
Time is running out, but we will take two short questions, no lectures. Please.
Okay, I'll try to resist the urge to lecture. First, full respect for all of the stuff that you're doing. I would like to pin you down sort of like a butterfly on one particular issue. And that is looking at your work from a more theological perspective. How do you consider the theme of salvation? There's a oft-repeated quote from Dostoevsky these days that beauty will save the world. And that a major role of art is to somehow bring some form of redemption or some form of improvement to the human condition. Do you see your work as going that direction in any particular way? And what is the kind of improvement that you'd be interested in bringing to life as we know it?
So,
do you mind if we take two questions? Or do you want to the very last one.
I'm very happy that I came here.
They listen to you both. You were this
great panel. You started from Martin Heidegger, you made a long tour, and in the end you came there to life and death. So, do you agree with his points of view, the Himmel, Erde, the Göttlichen, the Sterblichen, Mori Wundersum, you return to this after your long tour? I ask this question because I have been quite often there in the history. And Lord has been in that cabin,
Heidegger's
cabin. He spent his last, his years, and Jürgen Heidegger is my great friend, his son. So, I feel that this issue is very important, and then these borders between life and death can be crossed and passed. And you gave a nice collection of pictures related to life and death, and to this topic. We return to the name of Heidegger after your long tour.
Sure. Okay, so let me redemption and Heidegger.
quick response.
I
I have a book on financial markets called Confidence Games, Money in Markets in a World Without Redemption. Now, redemption in that context means multiple things. It's the theological, but also the redeeming. I don't believe in any kind of redemption that's extraordinary. I can't exactly think of a way in which I would use that term to characterize my thinking. It's a long story to get from that Kantian text with which I began, purposiveness without purpose. But I do believe in a certain way that the world's a work of art. And my favorite poet is an American poet named Wallace Stevens. And Stevens says it was my God and the imagination of one. So there is a certain kind of theology, or atheology, I mean, at work in what I've tried to do. But that's one of the reasons I focused on the word destruction this morning. I mean, creation and destruction are inseparable. Once you've been in a really, really, really dark place, light doesn't look the same. Any form of art or religion or philosophy that sort of takes one out of that moment of darkness, I can't accept. The problem is how to be able to live in that darkness without letting it overwhelm you. That's not exactly redemption. That seems to me to be the challenge of life. Heidegger is so charged in so many different ways, it's a long story. I think a lot of my thinking about place has been deeply influenced by Derrida. And much of what I say about place comes right out of his notion of cora. Lewis essay about that. And Derrida has written extensively on some of the subjects you invoked this morning, Ted. The notion of the paragraph, of the frame, the limb, the liminality. Derrida's whole essay on the third critique is about that limit, that border, that margin, that is very, very close to the Heideggerian risk, or the Heideggerian clearing, or opening, which is the interplay. The interplay of revealing and revealing, or revealing and concealing. And it's that oscillation or alternation between it's neither this and that is constantly appearing by this Kabbalistic moment in certain ways, the zitzu. Again, I don't know how it works in Swedish and in Danish, but in English, work is a verb and a noun. So the work of art is both the object and the process by which it is created or produced. And the work of art, it seems to me, is that clearing of that opening, which allows appearances to appear by whatever das Licht is, that is not simply, and that's the Heideggerian moment remains, I think, important and productive. So all of these things that I create, that's why all the forms are broken. Those concentric cubes are broken. The pyramid has a sitting on itself. They're inverted. The sphere is only half and has a hole in it. Right? They're all fragments, and the intersecting loops don't meet. It's double infinity, but it's closed, right? These moments are the open, and in the center, there is a void of a void in the void, right? But it's precisely the hub that allows the spokes of the wheel to emerge, and that's what we're always after. And again, after has a temporal ambiguity to it. We're subsequent to it because it creates the possibility for growth. And so it's always past, but precisely as that which is always past, it's always yet to come. So it's always, that's what we're always seeking, you know, that completion that we can never have, but, you know, the fulfillment of desire is that. That's the living in that. And the question of life is, you know, how one keeps desire open, even in the midst of all the darkness we know is around us.
The conference is just about to move from Martin Heidegger's cabin to Jan-Erik Andersson's cabin. Thank you so much for this philosophical rock concert.